I'm going to read in the New King James Version. It speaks a lot of things into my life, and I walk in accordance with that scripture. I don't like memorizing because I run the risk of saying incorrectly. But so it says, most assuredly I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also. And greater works than these he will do, because I go to my Father. And whatever you ask in my name, that I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it. And on the basis of that, I believe that as a child of God, I have been made to do great things. I have actually been empowered to do great things in life. And I do great things in life, whether you like it or you don't like it. Amen. But I believe it. Now, if you believe that, I want you to stand up and we'll say just a few declarations in the name of Jesus. Just stand up and do that. And you'll say it after me. Let's say, I declare and receive God's power over my life.
I declare and receive God's power over my life.
I declare and receive God's power over the ideas in my mind. And receive God's power over the ideas in my mind. I declare and receive God's power over the words of my mouth.
I declare and receive God's power over the words of my mouth.
I declare and receive God's power over the works of my hands.
I declare and receive God's power over the works of my hands.
I declare and receive God's power over every territory my feet will occupy. Amen. I don't feel like you believe that about yourself. How long have you guys been back at school for? Is it like, have you guys been back for a whole semester?
No.
You sound like you've been here for 3 semesters. No energy, very low, eh? But I pray that God will give you energy and believe that about yourself. Amen.
Amen.
Let us be seated. Since I have been advised by the leadership here that the theme for tonight, I don't know if it's a theme for the quarter, is obedience through faith, not through religion or cultural behavior. So that's the theme. I'm not going to treat the whole subject, but what I will speak to, which will respond to the theme, is the subject which says, do not defile yourself. Can I repeat that? Do not defile yourself. And we will take the scripture reading to anchor what we're talking about from Daniel chapter 1 verse 8. Let's go to Daniel chapter 1 verse 8. And I want to read it in the Message Bible because I think it communicates the message much better. Perhaps in fact, I will read the a couple of verses which will include verse 8. I'll start from verse 1. It says, it was the third year of King Jehoiakim's reign in Judah when King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon declared war on Jerusalem and besieged the city. The master handed King Jehoiakim of Judah over to him, along with some of the furnishings from the temple of God. Nebuchadnezzar took king and furnishings to the country of Babylon, the ancient Shinar. He put the furnishings in the sacred treasury. The king told Ashpenaz, head of palace staff, to get some Israelites from the royal family and nobility, young men who were healthy and handsome, intelligent and well-educated, good prospects for leadership positions in government, perfect. Wouldn't you like to be described like that? Everything about you. It says, so this guy was very smart, so he's looking for young men who were healthy, handsome, intelligent, and well-educated, good prospects for leadership, positions in government, perfect specimen. Hey, listen to that. Perfect specimen. Tall, slender, everything. That's what everybody is looking for to marry. Looking for the tall guy. All the short guys aren't going anywhere. Okay, listen. So, a perfect specimen, and indoctrinate them in the Babylonian language and the law of magic and fortune telling. The king then ordered that they be served from the same menu as the royal table, the best food, the finest wine. After 3 years of training, they will be given positions in the king's court. 4 young men from Judah, Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, Azariah were among those selected. The head of the puppet staff gave Babylonian names to Daniel, was named Belteshazzar. Hananiah was named Shadrach, Mishael was named Meshach, Azariah was named Abednego. But Daniel determined that he would not defile himself by eating the king's food or drinking his wine. So he asked the head of the palace staff to exempt him from the royal diet. Let's stop. Father, we thank you and bless you, God, for this word. We pray that, Lord, you explain it to us and that we receive the wisdom that comes from it in the name of Jesus. Amen. Saints, I want to talk on the subject of not defiling yourself. Now, we said the theme for the evening is obedience through faith and not through religion or culture, cultural behavior. Now, religion and culture are counted amongst the seven mountains of influence. And seven mountains of influence, things that shape society. Now, somebody will say to me, but what are the seven mountains of influence? And I will actually just tell you what they are. The transformation of nations will come through seven spheres of influence. One is family. Families influence society. The economy influences society. Government influences society. Education influences society. Media influences society. Celebration and celebrities influence society. And spirituality influences society. These are seven things which influence society. And we are called to actually not to succumb to the seven things, but as children of God, to shape those things. Now, if you don't know, when you come to university or to school, you don't come here as to have fun only. This is exactly where we socialize you so that you can become productive. That is why people who are educated have a problem with uneducated people. Not because uneducated people are stupid, because uneducated people play by different rules. Haven't you ever heard of somebody who says, I've never been to a university, but I know how to live life. You live life through different rules. Now, some people don't realize that when they come to university, they've come to be indoctrinated in a positive way. Some people are simple recipients of education without being critical about it. And they don't realize that education is actually influencing you to think in a particular way. And I can make an example. There's a gentleman you all know, probably, by the name of Richard Branson. Richard Branson owns Virgin Airlines. He used to own Virgin Records, and he owns Virgin Clubs, the health clubs. He never finished school. He was dyslexic. And he left school, and he decided he was going to be a businessman. The way he conducts his business is a very eccentric guy. He doesn't do it like the guys who wear neckties and look all pretty and perfect, but he does it by his own way, because he understands that his talents sit elsewhere. Now, education, culture, religion influence society. So if we are going to talk about obedience through God, through faith, not through religion, we are basically saying obedience through faith, not through the things that shape society. We only are going to be obedient to God by following the things that God wants us to do. Now, our God is a very, very jealous God. Our God is very jealous, if you don't know that. If you want to see what I mean, let's go to Exodus chapter 20, verse 1 to 4. You just bear with me. I want to lay the foundation for what I want to talk about, and we will get there. Exodus chapter 20, verse 1 to 4. And we'll read it in the NIV, where it says, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have what? No other gods before me. You shall not make yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven or above, in heaven above, or on earth beneath, or in the waters below. So he's a very jealous God.
Our God cannot be compared to any other God. Our God does not compete with any God. Our faith in God should not compete with any belief or any system. Our God does not want to be mixed up with anything that is ungodly, because He is a jealous God. We've got to establish that. And when we say we love God and have faith in Him, God demands total commitment from us to Him. He requires all of us, all of you, to be part of Him, because He's a jealous God. He cannot allow you to say you love Him today and tomorrow you go and worship some ancestors. He cannot allow you to say you love Him today and tomorrow you go and believe in magic. He cannot allow you to say you love Him today and you have some small God in your pocket, because He's a jealous God. You see, some people left home when you went to university. Somebody gave you a small thing to put in your pocket, so that every time you go and write your exam, you just pull it out and say, "My man, I'm writing the exam today. Look after me." Interesting thing is that thing has never seen a university class lecture. That thing has never written an exam. That thing does not know physics. It knows nothing. And my God cannot compete with that thing, because He's a jealous God. So when you come to God, you've got to love God with all of you, with everything about you. In Matthew chapter 22, verse 37, Jesus gave us a command that you shall love God with all what? Your heart. With all what? Your soul. And with all of your mind. What does that speak to? Your heart is that thing. You see, your heart is... it's not that organ that you guys do in biology. Your heart is that thing that you... this is why people are happy to give their heart to anybody. You know, the heart you're happy to give is not the real heart. It is that emotional thing. It is that emotional thing. People are happy to give that thing away. God wants that thing. He wants it for Himself. He also wants the soul, which is what connects you to Him, that spiritual dimension of you, and He also wants your mind. When you commit to Him, all of you must commit to God. So no part of our lives should be immune from divine influence. Your mind must not be immune from being influenced by God. Your heart must not be immune from being influenced by God. And your soul must not be immune from being influenced by God. And when you say you're a child of God and God rules over your life, you mean He rules over everything about you. The ideas that you have come from God. The talents that you have come from God. And He must rule over those things. So this is to position our God and our obedience to God, and understand that He is a supreme being. He can't be compared to anything. He can't be compared to your education. He can't be compared to money. He can't be compared to your friend. He can't be compared to anything. He is a sovereign God. And if you understand it like that, you position Him like that, then you'll know who you worship and you'll know who you obey. And you can't obey our God by half measures. You obey our God totally. So that's the first point we've got to make. And then we obey our God through faith. And we've got to say, but what does faith mean? What is faith? According to the New International Bible Dictionary, it says, faith has a twofold sense in the Bible. On the one hand, it means trust. It means reliance. And on the other hand, it means fidelity, trustworthiness. When you say, "I have faith in this guy," you mean that I trust him. When you say, "I have faith in my partner," you mean that I have fidelity in my partner. Yeah. I can close my eyes and I know this guy has my back. So we have obedience through trusting God. We have obedience through relying on God. We have obedience through God's being trustworthy. That's what it means. And faith is trust in the person of Jesus, the truth of His teaching, and the redemptive work He did on the cross. We don't just trust God out of nothing. We trust God because He did a wonderful work on the cross. He came from earth and from heaven and he died on earth so that you and I may be saved. And we trust him because of the sacrificial work that he did. That's why we obey God and have faith in God, because he paid the price that nobody else was prepared to pay. In Revelation, it talks about how one day the saints in heaven are sitting, and the angels are sitting, and all of the other senior people in heaven are sitting, and they ask, who can open the scroll? And the Bible says, nobody could qualify to open the scroll. Only the only person who died and redeemed her could open the scroll, because no one in heaven and on earth is equal to him. Now that establishes the faith connection with God. Now here's the point. You see, faith should not be confused with mere intellectual understanding of the gospel. Because there are Christians who are intellectual Christians, they are not totally committed to God. It's not an intellectual business, this faith that we're talking about. Our faith is not some intellectual assent to some doctrinal teaching of Christianity. Faith includes radical and total commitment to Christ. So that when you walk in this university, people will say, that girl is somebody who knows Jesus. That guy is somebody who knows and lives the faith of God. If you ask him anything, he will tell you where it comes from, because he knows who God is. Yeah. His mind is dominated by God. The works of his hands are dominated by God. The things that he speaks are dominated by God. Wherever he walks, things change because he's walking with God. That's someone who's got faith in God. You don't have faith in God because of some intellectual understanding. You have faith in God because you had an experience one day when you saw Christ on the cross and your sins became apparent to you and you said, Lord, I accept you as my Lord and personal Savior. That is what makes you have faith in God. Amen.
Amen.
So obedience through faith is obeying God. You know, one day, Christ talked about why it is important to know him as your Lord and personal Savior, so that however you describe him from a fan base. One day, Jesus has a conversation with his disciples. He says to them, so tell me, who do people say I am? Don't you think that was a strange question? This is the guy that I've been walking with every day. And he says, so tell me, you guys, who do people say I am? I want to take you to the conversation, and that conversation is in Matthew chapter 16, verse 13 to 18, in the NIV. Let's go there. Amen. Matthew 16, verse 13 to 18. So he says, when Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philip, he asked his disciples, who do people say the Son of Man is? They replied, some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets. But what about you? He asked, who do you say I am? Simon Peter answered, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Jesus replied, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father. And then he says, and I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it. You know why he said that? Because Peter described who Jesus in accordance with what Christ came to do. And he says, this is the foundation on the basis of which you have faith in God. And Peter says, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And that is what should be the basis of our obedience to God. Because if you stand on that truth, not even demons will shake you. Not even evil will shake you. Not even negative words will sway you. It doesn't matter what people say about you. You stand on a firm foundation of faith, and that foundation is, I accept the Son of the living God. And he speaks to me. And he shapes me. So now our obedience to God is built on something very firm. The problem that we have as Christians is that we have allowed our obedience to God to be shaped by the same things that influence the world. We have allowed our obedience to God to be shaped by the same things that influence the world. So, If a man of God came into this house and he was empowered by God to preach a wonderful way, and the sky does not smell of good perfume, he's not properly made up, his hair is not shaved, he looks like some dodgy guy, but he's got a powerful way. You look at him and say, oh, I just can't listen to this guy. I'm expecting a pastor to walk in and look at T.D. Jakes. He must speak like T.D. Jakes. Because that's what the world tells you. The world tells you that for anybody to speak the word of God, they must be properly made up. But where do you find that in the Bible? They say Jonah spoke in a shop in the desert. He looked so scruffy and he said, behold, the Son of God has come.
Amen.
And it changed people's hearts. We have allowed the world to determine how we relate with God. We have allowed the world to determine how we respect God. And here's another thing. Some people say if you are walking with God and He is in you, you will smell of money. Yes, you're blessed and highly favored. Everybody wants to be blessed and highly favored. Even those whose assignment does not require you to be blessed and highly favored, you want to smell. You only believe that God is with you and you should obey Him because you are what? You are blessed and highly favored. Children of God, let me tell you something this evening. Not everybody is blessed and highly favored because people who are blessed and highly favored have a higher calling. Not everybody was married in the name of Jesus, but everybody had a child. There was only one Mary, the mother of whom? Jesus. And she had to carry a child whom she saw one day crucified on the cross, and she cried. And she knew that her son had done nothing wrong, but it was a gift from God. She had carried something for 9 months and given birth to a child whom she never, ever, ever had time to spend and look after and to love. She saw him on the cross. You know why? Because she was blessed and highly favored. Some of us want to define our position and relationship with God out of material things. Our faith is not a faith of money. Our faith is a faith of what? Believing God. So we've allowed the world to define these things. We have allowed the world to define our faith and our obedience to go through miracles. What are miracles for? What is a miracle for? Do you need a miracle to pass it on? Do you need a miracle to pass it on? You just have to study. You study. But you need a miracle to be healed. God dispenses miracles for people to want to be healed, to be cured of demonic influences. Christ places His hand and a man is saved and he becomes pure again. Just because God has not performed a miracle in your life, you don't obey Him. Who said you deserve a miracle? You've got to obey God. You've got to have what? Faith in God. Not because of culture or religion. Because the things that tell you that you've got to believe in God because of some miracle, that is called what? Religion. Amen.
Amen.
I'm not come to change stuff. I'm just thinking about the Bible. You're going to find it. Find it. Find it in the Bible. So we allow our faith to be defined by what the world does. And instead of following God because we know the work He did on the cross. It's as simple as that. Now let me tell you something. Because you are young people, people will say when you understand God, they will not respect you. But in 1 Timothy chapter 4 verse 12, it says something. It says, don't let anybody look down upon you because you are what? You are young. Don't do that. But here's what God says. Don't let anyone think less of you because you are young and you are a Christian. Be an example to all believers in what you say, in the way you live, in your love, your faith, and your purity. If you understand who you are obeying as a young person, be an example through them. Secondly, Paul says, focus on reading the scripture. Know the scripture so you will not be deceived by anyone who wants to twist the truth.
Yeah.
We love the title of man of God. And your Bible is who? Man of God. Let me tell you tonight, your Bible and what God says, you and I can read it with our own eyes and with our own mouth. We don't need any man of God to tell us who God is. We read what the Bible says who God is. The reason why young people today will be influenced by things of the world in their relationship with God is because they don't read the Bible. Don't read the Bible. All you will tell me is, you know what? T.D. Jakes said about the Bible, about God. And John Wilson told me this about the Word of God and who God is. You can't tell what God is saying to you when you read the Bible. That's why when people who are false prophets come, they easily sway you and they abuse you and leave you hating God. Not because of what God said, but what some men of God said. Your relationship with God must be based on understanding the Word as a young person, because God says you must understand the Word.
Yeah.
Read the Word. So that your relationship with Him is based on faith, on understanding who He is, not because of culture, not because of some doctrine, but because you understand who God is. And you can have that foundation as a young person. The other thing which Paul says is, do not neglect the spiritual gift you received through the prophecy spoken over you. You know, all of us have got an assignment from God. When God brought us onto this earth, He said, I have an assignment for you. Let me explain the difference between an assignment and your occupation. Your assignment from God always stands. It's one. But you may have different occupations in your lifetime. And if you want to see an example of what the assignment is, look at the life of Joseph. Joseph was born and was given a dream to be a leader. One day he was a shepherd looking after sheep, and the other day he was actually sold as a slave, and the next time he was actually sold, he was in prison, but he was always a dreamer about being a leader. His vocation was going to be a leader of people. Now here's the thing, as a child of God, you must focus on the talents which God has given you, and treasure them and pray about them. Don't be swayed by people who want to remove you from your faith in God, because the moment you move, you will lose your assignment. Some of us say, "Unkulunkulu uyakudlulisa njenga university. Uzoyithatha le degree yakho to be a doctor, you'll never work as a doctor. But the thing that you'll do and you'll flourish, you'll be a man of God, a woman of God. But understand your vocation. Don't ever lose sight of what God has placed in your heart. Because when you have faith, and your faith is based on listening to God, you hold on to what is said to you. Third point. Give your complete attention to all of these matters. Throw yourself into the task of believing God and doing the things that God wants you to do. And as you do that, your faith will be strengthened. Now, God, how do you obey God through faith in a world where too many things are competing for your influence? How do you obey God? I came to university here to study, but when I came to Joburg and the lives of Joburg are very bright. If you want to get to the top here, you must get a good job. If you want to get to the top here, you must associate with the right friends. If you want to get to the top here, stop talking in tongues. Tongues ain't going to get you to invest in them. They're not going to get you to Standard Bank or APSA. They are not going to get you to Anglo-American. If you want to get to Anglo-American, bury your head in the books. That's the way of the world. The world wants to take you away from God and put you in the systems of the world. And once you've been neutralized and placed in the systems of the world, you will struggle just like everybody. There is one thing which Daniel did. And this is why we're saying, do not allow yourself to defy the faith. What did Daniel do? Daniel and all those boys were taken as prisoners to a different country. When they got there, the king of Nebuchadnezzar knew that the boys of Israel were blessed by God. They had talents from God, and he wanted to use them for his own ends. And what does it do? He says, find the boys who are perfect, who are beautiful, and have been properly taught, and strip them of their godly nature. You see what the world does? The world knows that you're a good person. The world knows that you're a powerful person, blessed by God. And what the world does, first of all, in order to disempower you, is to change. And some of us don't realize how the world changes us. The first thing that the world does is change your name. Your name seems to be a child of God, you become that girl. Then your name seems to be a confident young person who's been blessed by God with talents and stuff. And all of a sudden you are told that you're a black person who doesn't know anything. And when did God ever say that about you? When did God say that about you? And you start seeing yourself, when you get to this place, you start seeing yourself as a poor person. And whoever says your name is a poor person. When you read the word of God, it says, God knew you before you were born, and He put you together, and is make sure that your future is bright and you are going to prosper for as long as you follow him. Your name is, you are blessed, you are a child of God. You belong to a royalty. When God made you, he said what? Be fruitful and what? Multiply and dominate what? The world. That is the covenant which God made between you and us. But somehow, when you come into this world, you do what Nebuchadnezzar did to Daniel and the boys, he says, change the names. And allow yourself to change your name. And you forget what God said to you. And what does it say? The next thing is, feed them the food that comes from the royal household. Feed them the ideas of the royal household. This is what most of us do. When we come to places like this and you know that God has brought you here, you accept being fed the ideas of the world. You consume them without being critical. Your spiritual diet dies. That's why you're prepared to walk away from your faith, because you're starting to be fed the ideas of the world. Your diet is stellar of anything nutritious that comes from God. When they tell you that you're done, you receive. When they tell that you will fail, you receive it. When they tell that a person like you will never get anywhere, you receive it. And when you ask, whose image are you? In whose image were you made? Whatever happened to the faith that you're supposed to have in the name of Jesus? But Daniel, the boy said, Daniel said, hey, I'm not going to eat the food from the royal household. I'll eat the diet that I know. I will read the Bible that I know. I only follow the ideas which I know, because I know who brought me here. Now here's the thing that I want to tell you. I like the fact that in the vision that you have here, there is something called power. The power of the kingdom which you should have over your life. You should embrace the power which God has given you. The power which God has given you is very important. The power which God has given you does not care about gender. It doesn't care about race. It doesn't care about where you come from. It only cares about who you worship. These boys knew who they worshipped. So here's the thing that happened. You're supposed to keep, they kept their faith pure. Not just, and keeping your faith pure is not just a supernatural thing. Keeping your faith pure is an active act. You move. When you come into the company of bad people who are going nowhere, you don't mix up with them. I want to talk about you hang out with people that are not going anywhere. Who's bullshit? Who are in the company of bad people? Now you want to be prophetic and all powerful and hang out with the bad crowd. And then you come here and you cause us to pay for you. What are we paying for? This thing does not require any supernatural intervention. Just get out of it. Get out of it. But no, let's tell you why. You want an ignite, that's a panic. But come and drink the wine here. But you put the wine. We are feeling what you have in the food. You have a husband's engine. You tell us, daddy, don't you? No. There was an active step of going to the company of people that are drinking, and there was an active step of opening alcohol, and you took it in a drunk and you didn't drink it. Once you drink it several times and you got drunk, there is absolutely nothing there of you didn't get drunk by osmosis. It was an active. Your faith. They did not want to define their faith. They did not want the world to shape how they think. You know what I'm saying? They didn't just listen and follow the Babylonian system of thinking, which is the education of the world. They read the Bible. They understood who their God was, and it shaped them. Now, here's the thing which most of us don't understand. You see, Daniel had to do all of that in the Babylonian system. You know how the Babylonian system works? It was a very, very rich system. It was a system powerful in knowledge. It was a system powerful in the arts. It was a system powerful in politics. It shapes you. Today, we live in a system like that, where young people and old people are faced with a barrage of information. So we've become uncritical consumers of what influences us. But to my soldier, when I saw the relationship in Scapuza today, in a fellowship with God, and he'll come down. Where have you ever read that? Where have you ever read that? Your faith must be based on something, not a culture, because cultures change. You know, there are some people today who are going to get lost and will not finish their studies here because they got here, God brought them here, and when they got here, they followed the Babylonian system. And you forgot why God brought you here. You see, you must search God and ask Him, Father, why have you brought me here? I want to hear from you. Father, you've enabled me to enroll for this BSc, to enroll for medicine. Why do you want me to be a doctor? And what kind of doctor do you want me to be? And God will give you guidance. He will not leave you here on your own. Some of you were praying so hard and not so hard, and you sought God, and God answered the prayers, and He brought you by faith. You are here. And when you got here, you start thinking, oh, God is stupid. The things of God don't work. But I want to tell you tonight, the things of God do work. And you can be 10 times smarter than everybody else because you only worship God.
Amen.
You know, at the end, you know what happened with these boys, with Daniel and strength? They said when they tested them, they found them to be 10 times smarter than the other guys who were drinking the ordinary stuff. And that thing can still happen to you. For as long as your faith is in God and in His faith, and you obey God because of your faith in Him, not because of the ideas of man. The people who are going to make a difference today in our world today are not the people who follow the system of the world. It's the people who follow something absolutely unique and something absolutely powerful. You see, when you follow God and you've got faith in God, not in the ideas of men, you have uncommon ideas. When you follow God, you have uncommon thoughts. When you follow God, you have uncommon dreams. You speak in the language of God. You speak in the language of heaven. And the reason why some people don't believe it is because they don't want to totally accept God. You accept God, and then you say, but I don't think God understands biology. I don't think God understands physics. He doesn't understand physics. I don't think God understands business. I don't think He understands business. I don't think God understands commerce. When you read the Bible, everything was made by who? By God. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. Oh, by the way, if you think you're the smartest person to ever walk on earth, and you are the smartest young people on earth, you are not the first person on earth. There are many smart people who walk with God. People like Joseph, people like David, people like, you can count a lot of them. They were smart young people and they were found to be 10 times smarter than everyone because they did what? They followed God. Don't look down on your faith. Don't compromise on your faith because culture tells you so. You know, you can become the most powerful musician because you're a child of God. Who knows Dr. Doom? You know Dr. Doom? Is he a rubbish musician? No. Is he a child of God? Yes. Is he a doctor? Yes. Is he practicing medicine? No. What is he doing? Singing. Singing for who? God. And that's calling back. That's who? Calling back. Can we? God can make you what He wants to be just because you follow Him. There are no Jehovah that has that. When you have any faith in Him, God doesn't embarrass you. Anybody brought up by God, you will never be embarrassed.
Jesus.
So I've got a testimony. My own personal testimony. I grew up in a very poor home. Two-bedroom house. I've got three sisters. I never had a bedroom when I grew up. I always used to dream that I'd have a bedroom. But I never had a bedroom. I used to sleep in the sitting room. I was the first one to wake up in the morning and the last one to go to bed. Because I had to make sure that there are no guests in the sitting room. And sometimes, you know, we'd go home without electricity for years and no water. But my mother was good. She was a praying woman. All of those things didn't matter because I was born into that. I didn't choose that. But you know what God does? He takes you and He makes you. He takes and does what? He makes you. And when He wants to pray, He makes you even very well. He changes your life because you stay in the course. I walk in places where people like me don't deserve to walk. I sit with people who, if they knew where I came from, they wouldn't believe I'm sitting with them. So I took my son over December. I said, let me go and show you where I was born.
Because these young kids don't know where we come from. They wake up and they see stuff and they think they're born here in the northern side of Johannesburg. So I took him and I said, my boy, come and see where I was born. I showed him this place. I said, so I used to stay there, 2-bedroom house, and I used to sleep in, in the sitting room. And he says to me after, I says, Daddy, you guys are really poor, eh? And I said to him, I want you to see this so that you can know what God does in a person's life. God doesn't care where you come from. God doesn't care what you really want to do. He cares about where he wants to take you. If you have what? Faith in God. Don't allow anybody to disparage the God that you worship. Don't allow anybody to tell you that the God that you worship will not take you anywhere. Listen to the ideas of men. Receive the totality of God and allow it to change. And your relationship with God must not be based on things. It must be based on the cross. Amen. In Jesus' name. And you know what? If you do that, you'll determine and resolve in your mind that you shall not allow the world and its ideas to change your name and identity. You shall not allow the world to change and corrupt your spiritual diet. You shall not allow the world to determine the ideas in your mind. You shall not allow the world to define and determine your success. You shall not allow the world to make us forget who God is. He is the rock of ages who's done many things for many people. That's why we've got to trust him. Our obedience of God shall not be shaped by the same things that influence the world. Only the things that God wants. That's all. Strong. Don't follow God out of a celebrity culture. Follow God because you know who He is in your life. When I'm at about time to Jesus, I'm going to Jesus, that person who is looking cool in a tier 7. And sometimes it just will be a man's way. But if you know Him, you can shake it, because the next time the celebrity thing that you're following, was strong. If I'm not going to repent because somebody else is falling, but you stand because of the salvation of God. Now, that is what it means to obey God through faith. Because it's a jealous God. Don't mix up my God with your ideas. Mix him up with his own ideas. Amen. Let's close our eyes.